told you so. Having fun,
got money fun. Good morning, VT Radio Universal and Facebook Live. This is Sonda Swanberg signing in for Doris Hughes Green here and her radio show, A New Beginnings. I have with us today author Shane Nicolich. Am I pronouncing that right?
It's Shane Nicolich.
Nicolich.
Yeah.
And Shane is a local Tacomian here. He is an author. He wrote a book called Live the Passionate Life. It is an awesome book for people to encourage you no matter what you're going through. He talks about several different things that you talk about, several different things that you went through growing up all the way from childhood and into your early adulthood. And then you talk about how you overcame those things. You want to share a little bit with us about some of the things that you went through?
Yeah. Basically, I grew up as a young child. I was intelligent, you know, started reading at a very young age. I was reading the newspaper fluently with my grandpa at 3 years old when I was living with them when I was very young. And, you know, I just continued on that path until, you know, and I was in the gifted program when we lived in Everett. In grade school from second to fifth grade, and then when we moved back down to Enumclaw, ended up getting a house over by Lake Taps, but just a few days later, just a couple days after my 11th birthday, on July 14th, 1986, I fell out of a tree 40 feet and suffered a traumatic brain injury and was in a coma for 2.5 months, and that's really, you know, sort of stopped things there for a little bit, but not very long, because I was just kept on moving once I woke up. And, you know, of course, went into physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy there for a couple months anyway, because I had a trach in my throat while I was in the coma, and my left side is paralyzed while I was in the coma. So still today, it's weaker than my right. But you know, I just kept carrying on, graduated from high school, and a few years later, got married, and then found out I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis after a car accident, triggered the physical symptoms of the disease.
You know, you're the second person that I've met that was in a, I don't know how terrible, I'm going to assume it was a terrible car accident. He was a coworker of mine. It was a really terrible accident, was hit by a semi, and it was actually that brought on the onset of the symptoms. Mm-hmm. And you also were very open in your book about your journey through addiction. How old were you when you started using?
Well, looking, you know, thinking back to the first time I can remember drinking alcohol. I'm pretty sure it was beer, but I remember drinking alcohol when I was like 3, I think, and got real dizzy, fell down the concrete steps on the front porch of some family's house we were at. And, you know, I don't know, I fell down and got hurt. That's about all I remember that time. And then, of course, there's a couple more times when I was very young, you know, 3 and 4 years old, when I can remember, you know, drinking alcohol. But, you know, and just the feelings that came with it, and it just, you know, took me out of myself. But at any rate, then when I was 12 was when I, after the brain injury, you know, when I first started getting into the alcohol and drug scene.
So that was fairly soon after?
Yeah, I'd say within a year after, like, About a year after, year and a half after I got home from the hospital there.
Okay. Do you think that it had anything to do with maybe some frustrations or what you were going through with trying to recover from your traumatic brain injury and the coma and all of that?
Oh, definitely, definitely. Of course, you know, just freshly coming home from the hospital after being in a coma for 2.5 months, going through rehab, still going through physical and occupational therapy. I think I was going twice a week, maybe three times a week at that point. But my parents had been, when I was home, my parents had been, you know, keeping me busy there in the house, at home, in the yard, you know, or else we'd go somewhere as a family and I'd stay with them the whole time. And it's like, as soon as my parents let me out into the neighborhood to, you know, hang out with my friends, with kids my own age, it's like, you know, I just gravitated toward those, like naturally gravitated toward those wrong kid, wrong crowd. Mm-hmm. The kids your parents don't want you to hang around, I was hanging around them. And started doing what they were doing, you know, smoking cigarettes, drinking, you know, smoking pot, doing drugs, whatever they were doing, I was doing it. And yeah, just carried on for 4.5 years doing that. And, you know, life went down the crapper, if you will.
I think that a lot of people naturally gravitate towards that side when they're dealing with something big in their life. I also am a recovering addict, and for me, a big part of it was, I believe that opened me up to that, was because I was in an abusive home, and I was being molested by my stepfather. And so it was just a way to escape what was going on, and if I could be high when I got home, then it didn't matter, you know, what happened. Yeah. So that's why I had asked what I asked. And then, so despite having MS, you have done many different hiking. You've been on marathons. What was that, just to prove to yourself that the disease wasn't going to take you? What kind of got you going on that path to wanna to push yourself like that?
Well, I've even before my brain injury, when I was a young kid, I've always been active. I think my dad bought my first bicycle when I was 3, and you know, started riding bikes then. And before my brain injury, up until my brain injury, I raced BMX from the time I was like 7, I think. And as a young kid, I think I was 6, when the year that my dad for Christmas, rather than buying my stepmom a new washer and dryer, my dad went down and bought me a YZ50, a Yamaha YZ50 motorcycle. And you know, I'm just always been active and moving around, doing stuff, doing something. And then even after my brain injury, I, you know, walked. I was walking, well, granted, you know, half the time I was, well, most of the time, pretty much all the time, I was using it as an excuse to, you know, so I could be off on my own, so I could smoke cigarettes. But anyway, I was walking. Rather than riding the school bus, I would walk a mile and a half to school. And, you know, they're at Lake Ridge Junior High, and now it's a middle school. But at any rate, you know, and I always ride my bike a couple miles during the summer and the warmer months, ride my bicycle, BMX bike, a couple miles, maybe 3 miles to the public library there in Bonnie Lake to get books to read and bring those home and whatever. And, you know, I was just riding my bike all over. And then I was riding my mountain bike everywhere I went till I was 27 years old. When I finally gave in, I had always been of the mind that I was fearful of getting a driver's license because I didn't trust, I had fear of my eye-hand coordination because of the brain injury. And why, I don't know, but it just stuck with me, so I never got a license. And
well, a car's different. I mean, we're talking about 2,000 tons of metal going down the road versus, yeah. You know, bike is, what, 10 to 15 pounds, if that? So.
Yeah. But, and I was even given a car at one point. I was given a 1980 Toyota Corolla. It was actually a Toyota Rolla. It looked like it had been beat up or rolled down a mountain a couple times. Anyway, at the time, I didn't have the financial resources to, you know, maintain the car, pay for gas, insurance, all that. So I just rode my bike everywhere I went for years till I was 27. And I was married at the time and figured, okay, I'm going to need a job. So I need to think about getting a car. And I don't know about that, though, you know, with my coordination. Well, I talked to my dad, and my dad's like, dude, you just rode your frickin' mountain bike from Seattle to Portland. You know, that was the 2002 STP that I rode. And my dad's like, you know, brought that to my attention. I'm like, okay, I think you got a point there. And anyway, it's like, so I immediately, almost immediately went down, got my license and, you know, started driving. And got a job delivering pizza and got away from the bicycle, got away from being that active. Then, you know, like 5 years later, I got in a car accident, triggered my multiple sclerosis. I was out of work for a while and got back into walking and riding my bicycle almost everywhere I went. And then it just progressed from there. Like, I got another car, got a job, but then next year I kept being active, got back into hiking, if you will, and started hiking all the major peaks around here. Little Si, Mount Si, went up to Enumclaw, and I hiked Mount Peak, which isn't a major peak, but I hiked it, like, I don't know, probably 100 times that spring. And, you know, just doing all the hiking I could. Hiked up to Camp Muir for the first time that year with a fellow MSer, another guy who has MS. He's a major hiker. And, you know, kept on hiking that year. The next year I got back into cycling, rode Bike MS up there in Mount Vernon, raising money for the National MS Society to help find a cure. And, you know, the next year I got into running. I'm still running today. As a matter of fact, today, I haven't run yet today, but today is day 694 of my never-ending run streak I started.
Oh, wow. And so are you still hiking as well?
Actually, I haven't as of recently, probably in a couple of years, but I do want to get back to it.
Okay. Yeah, I know that bike trip that you took from here to Portland was so that you could attend a conference for Alcoholics Anonymous. Have you done
no.
or no?
Did I remember that wrong? Yeah, actually, that bike ride was when I was just before my 20th birthday. I was living up in Enumclaw, and I was in the 12-step program up there, and heard about this international convention going on down in San Diego that year, that June. And I had friends from Enumclaw and the surrounding area that were going down there. And I didn't have a car, wasn't driving at the time. And so I'm like, well, you know, I don't really want to fly down. How am I going to get down there? Because I can't really afford anything. and one of my friends suggested, well, hey, you ride your bike everywhere. Why don't you ride your bike down there? So I'm like, okay, sure, why not?
Yeah, that sounds incredible. I had forgotten it was all the way down to San Diego, which is, I've been there. I've driven to Sacramento, but I've only flown to San Diego, so I can't imagine a bicycle.
I actually didn't ride the entire way on my bicycle. I started in Aberdeen, Washington, and made it to Newport, Oregon over the course of 3 days. Took me a total of 20 hours riding time. But,
and then you took the bus, right?
Yeah. And then I was sitting on the side. I was going up this long, I don't know if it was really steep, but it was a long hill. And I'm just like, my legs are tired, and I'm just like, oh man, this sucks. So I set my bike down on the side of the road. I was off on this slope on the side of the road, dirt slope. And I don't know, I was just sitting there, all my bags and everything on my bike, and I'm sitting there for a couple minutes thinking, oh man, this sucks. I gotta stretch out or something. So I tried stretching out, ate a couple bananas, drank a bunch of water. Still, my legs are killing me, and so I'm like, I just sort of gave up almost, and I'm like, stuck up my thumb, and I'm like, okay, God, if it's your will, get me there. Not more than a minute goes by, and a couple guys I knew from Seattle just happened to be driving by in their Volkswagen van and picked me up, and just had enough room for my bike and my bags and me, and I was crouched down in this tiny space in the back, you know, next to my bike, and just enough room. It's like, wow, this just happened just right. And I went surfing with them there in Albany, or no, they're in Newport, and they gave me a ride to Albany because they happened to be on their way to Bend, Oregon. And dropped me off there. I stayed the night in a motel, caught Greyhound the next day with my bag and everything, went down to San Diego.
Wow. So did that kind of put an end to wanting to ride your bike, like, long distances? Because you always hear these tours to, you know, there's the Seattle to Portland run that they do every year, you know. Have you done anything like that? I didn't remember reading.
Yeah, I did Seattle to Portland back in 2002. As a matter of fact, I just get, ooh, that was so cool. But it was just like a super cool thing about that ride was that, and I was in tears as I was the last like quarter mile to the finish line there in Portland, because it was because in 2002 I rode both days on Saturday and Sunday, Saturday July 13th, Sunday July 14th. If you remember, July 14th, 1986 was when I fell out of the tree. I hit the ground at exactly 2:53 p.m. I know that because that picture is still in my head today. That's what time my watch stopped, and when I hit the ground, and I finished the Seattle to Portland. I crossed the finish line in Portland on Sunday, July 14th, 2002, at right about 3 or 4 in the afternoon. And so it was like, you know, 26 years later, you know, after hitting the ground, falling out of the tree, landing, and as I like to jokingly say about it, I fell out of the tree 40 feet and landed in Tacoma. Because it was in Bonnie Lake or up by Lake Taps, but I ended up after I went to Good Sam where they stabilized me. And then I went here in Tacoma, just a few blocks away, to St. Joseph's Hospital.
Oh, okay.
Or St. Joseph Medical Center. And I was there in ICU for a month or maybe a little longer.
Okay. One of the things that I caught my attention at the beginning, and what you don't know about me yet, is I'm a master certified health and wellness coach. And you talk a couple of times in your book about cleaning up your diet and how you felt like that gave you more energy. And can you expound on that?
Yeah, definitely. Even before my before my multiple sclerosis, when I was down with chronic or clinical depression and fatigue, and I was living there in Enumclaw at an apartment by myself, and I was always seeking. I've always been searching, seeking for, you know, better things, a better way. And so anyway, I was sitting there down with this depression and fatigue and wanted, you know, I was reading up, researching, watching videos on the internet of, you know, different speakers and different health and wellness guys talking about, you know, their, you know, the way that they see things and, you know, different diets and everything. And I paid attention, you know, okay, well, I've been, you know, I'm doing things wrong. I'm, you know, and at the time I was depression and fatigue. I mean, go figure, sitting at home eating most of the time. And, of course, eating, I'd go over to the store and get a box or a big bag of cereal and come home with that and a gallon of milk and devour the whole thing. And, None to say the least, it wasn't a healthy diet or anything. Drinking gallons of coffee. I was drinking probably at least 2 pots of coffee a day. And I just got to the point where it was like, okay, something's got to change. So that was when I started to change my diet. Although, you know, it's like, oh, and Mountain Dew. I was chugging at least a 2-liter Mountain Dew every couple of days.
Wow.
Closer to one a day. But, you know, and so it's like diet. That probably had, that could have had a major play in my multiple sclerosis in itself. But, or at least, you know, it did have a play, I figure. But now having multiple sclerosis, you know, and that diagnosis thrown in my face, you know, and, well, I live with it, you know, it's not really thrown in my face, it is my face. But it's like, you know, knowing that I now live with this incurable disease, multiple sclerosis, of course, I'm going to do whatever I can do and everything I can do to live better with it and to diminish any symptoms, right? And so that's when I really started focusing on action. You know, what am I going to do? I'm going to become a lot more active. And that's when I started hiking a lot more, cycling a lot more, you know, just totally gave myself into it. I've totally given myself into running. I mean, I run every day. It's like, started out, I was just going to, you know, I figured, okay, I'm going to start running. Maybe I'll, you know, but I'm just going to run shorter distances, never going to run half marathons like I see my aunt post on Facebook all the time. Never gonna do that. That's crazy. And it's like within, I think it was within 7 months. I could be wrong, but I think it was 7 months until my first full marathon that I ran from the time I started running. And it's just, I've run many races since then. And I've run a 12-hour race or endurance run last year up on Bainbridge Island. I ran the Pac Rim one day, 24-hour run down in Longview last year. I was going to do it again this year, but of course, all the races are canceled because of what's going on in the world with the virus thing and the quarantine. But it's like, you know, so action, and the other thing is diet. And, you know, just eating healthier, focusing on eating more natural foods rather than processed foods, drinking more plain water rather than water flavored with coffee beans. And, you know, although here's my coffee here, but this is my one cup for the day. You know, and it's like I probably won't even finish that like I've been doing lately. You know, and it's like just getting back to nature, the natural foods, you know, and water, water and juices and vegetables, fruits and vegetables. I'm really big on those these days. Although I, you know, my weakness is cookies, and I limit my cookies. You know, I only eat so many, and okay, that's enough for today. Put those aside. You know, I don't even want to look at those. You know, because if I do, I can go back to my old habits just like that, and you know, before I know it, you know, like back in the day, I'd sit down to my computer, and before I knew it, this whole bag of Reese's Pieces peanut butter cups are gone. You know, and it's like, you know, so I just don't even get those anymore. Don't even go there. You know, it's just like with the alcohol and drugs. I just don't even go there anymore. And, you know, it's like, my life is phenomenal these days. I couldn't ask for any better.
Good. Your book, your second half of the book is, then you switch over into mindset, talking about how to live more positively, how you came to write your book. Why don't you tell us a little bit about how you got inspired to write your book?
Well, how I got inspired to write my book, let's see. Actually, okay, here it is right here. I'm just going to read this. Here it is. Going to read this little bit from the beginning of my book, or the beginning of my story anyway. When I have shared bits and pieces of my story with people through the years, I have been told I'm inspiring. I have thought a few times about putting my story in print, but haven't done so yet. A couple of years ago, a young woman began working as a server at the restaurant where I was washing dishes. Regardless of the positive facade I was showing the world at the time, I was in one of my Eeyore states of mind and had been for a while. Woe is me, I'm never going to amount to anything. Life sucks, and then you die. That's the thinking I had anyway, you know, the type of thinking, mindset I was in. The new server had this positive vibe or aura about her that I latched onto. I woke one morning and thought, why am I in such a dark state of negativity? Screw that noise. I have so much to be grateful for. Negativity, exit stage left. Let the good times roll. I made a gratitude list and once again came to the realization that while my life may not be what I'd like it to be at any particular point in time, I'm still alive and not 6 feet under as of yet. So why not be grateful and positive? Some days my mind seems to be all about negative thinking, but I simply need to think about the things I am grateful for, and the negative thinking melts away. And, you know, shortly after that, like that time period, I had an MS, a flare-up of my multiple sclerosis after a cold I had. So the cold I had, you know, caused the exacerbation, flared up my MS symptoms. And so I'm just like, you know, I was at home for a while. And I saw this, I was depressed and everything about, you know, not being able to work. And I was sitting there and saw this ad on Facebook. Brendan Burchard had an ad on Facebook saying, hey, you know, he was advertising his book, The Motivation Manifesto, and said, you know, he was talking about his book, talking about motivational stuff, and I really latched onto that. And then he's like, you know, a free book, you know, pay $7 shipping anywhere in the world, get my book for free. And so I'm like, $7 for the book? Sure, why not? You know, see what's up with this. Can't hurt. So I bought the book, and it showed up in the mail, and I just devoured that book and, you know, read the whole thing, and I was done reading it, and I'm like, I'm going to read it again. That was good. So I read it again, and something in there, you know, reading the book and what he had to say in there, and, you know, just the Motivation Manifesto motivated me to write my own manifesto. And, you know, so I had to write my own autobiography, write my life story down. And, you know, of course, I can't just do that and hope that that motivates and inspires people. I mean, I hope it does anyway. But, you know, so I went off, you know, I had these 9 declarations of personal power that Brendon Burchard talks about in his book. I had those in my head, so I wanted to expound on those and how they work, how they apply to my life, you know, and maybe hopefully get people thinking about, you know, get motivated or inspired to be better, to do better. Actually, at this point would be
a perfect
time to read this paragraph. I've been doing Facebook Live and Instagram Live readings out of my book and out of Brendon Burchard's book, The Motivation Manifesto, for the past few days. And I was flipping through my book the other day, and I ran across this paragraph. You know, it's like, I wrote the book, I should know it already, I should know where it is. But reread this paragraph the other day, and it's like, bam, perfect summary or synopsis of my book. Anyway, that being said, I've touched on the 3 types of lives we can lead: prisoned, pleasant, or passionate. In the prisoned life, we simply make choices as they come, not really weighing out any consequences of our choices in dealing with whatever happens to come our way, whether we like it or not. In the pleasant life, we weigh out the consequences of our choices and opt for the more positive consequences, as long as we can remain comfortable and not have to take too much action, thus staying in our pleasant state. In the passionate life, we certainly weigh out the consequences of all our choices, always opting for the more positive ones, regardless of the actions that must be taken, because we are passionate about living a positive and progressive life. And, you know, that's just pretty much where I'm at in life these days, you know. Making positive choices, clean and sober living, you know, trying to live the best life possible. You know, given my circumstances with the, you know, living with symptoms, very few limited symptoms, my traumatic brain injury left over, living with multiple sclerosis and any symptoms of this disease, I am sort of an advocate for, you know, brain injury awareness and multiple sclerosis awareness, living with those. I do Walk MS. This year it's canceled, of course, so, you know, looking at doing the virtual Walk MS,
Yeah, how does that work?
But Walk MS, you get together. The past few years it's been down here at Chambers Bay in University Place, and raise money, people donate money to your personal cause or your personal collection that goes to the National MS Society, all geared toward, you know, finding a cure for MS. But, you know, and everyone gets together there at Chambers Bay and walks a mile or 2 miles, depending on how far you want to walk. Or you can walk all the way around the golf course. It's like 3 or 4 miles. And I've done that before, walked around the entire golf course, which is cool. But by the time I get back up to the building,
restaurant?
No, well, it's sort of by the restaurant.
The pro shop?
Environmental Services Building. That's what it's
called. Oh, a little further down. Okay.
But that's where the main event's held. By the walking around the whole golf course, by the time I get back up there, everything's pretty much all shutting down. The lunch is all gone, and it's like, okay, forget that. I'm gonna stick up top. I'll just do a mile or two. Well, being a runner now, last year I ran it. You know, I just ran alongside everyone on the side of the path. But, you know, it's like, okay, I'm going to get this done real quick. But anyway, the virtual it's like, you know, you still raise money via the via your personal page on their website, or, you know, just round up the money and then put it into a check, send it to them. But this year being virtual, you can do the mile or half mile or 2 miles or however far you want to walk or run anywhere you want. And just, you know, you're still part of the thing. You're signed up on the on their website, but you don't have to go to a particular location, especially since the golf course is closed. Yeah, I drove by there the other day because I run there often, but, you know, yeah, go figure. In the past, for the past 10 or whatever, 9 or 10 years, maybe longer, I've been going there for walk MS, and now that I'm a runner, I go there and run around the golf course, you know, just for my training runs.
Wow. I that's one of my favorite walks, but it can be a bit intimidating, and I'll usually will start over on the far end where they're going to be building the retirement center or whatever that is. And, you know, you walk all the way down and then you come back up by the pro shop. That hill is grueling, and I can't imagine it'd be any better going down, because you go through that wooded area and it's pretty steep there too. So
actually the windy hill on the north side, the windy hill going through the woods, that one, I prefer to go down and come up the other one. And one of my, a lady that runs a running and walking group up there in Bonnie Lake, the Tahale Runners, my friend Justine, she's like, why don't you go the other way, you know? That hill coming up by the restaurant there, that's a killer to come up. Why don't you go down that hill and up the other one? And I don't know, for some reason, the hill coming up there, the steep hill by the restaurant, always seems like it's better to come up.
I know. Mentally, I'm like, I should try it the other way. And then when I think about it, I'm like, nah, this is probably the best way to come. I'm exhausted by the time I do it. So your book has a lot of really great lessons in it. You know, lessons for people who are just going through things, whether they're similar things that you've gone through or their own life issues, things for small business owners. And one of the great gems that I took away from there was you're grateful. You're very grateful for having a job as a dishwasher, which, you know, in society, they look down on it. And I'm sure you've heard many times, oh, Shane, you're smarter than that. You can have a better job than that. You can do whatever. But you're happy in having this job. It provides for you, and it allows you to do what you were passionate about doing at the time, was writing your book. And you're still working as a dishwasher, right?
Currently I'm doing DoorDash deliveries.
Okay. Because of what's going on.
Because the whole quarantine thing. Pretty much as soon as the quarantine started, the restaurant where I work, which, you know, I'm still like technically employed at that restaurant, just not working, because they went to, because of the quarantine, everything
can't eat inside.
It was slowed way down, and so they cut down, they basically limited service, just takeout and delivery, no dine-in, so it's like they don't have as many. They don't have dishes to wash, you know, except the prep dishes and what the sushi chefs dirty up. But, you know, so there's limited dishes. And so they didn't need a dishwasher. And I'm currently doing DoorDash deliveries, and I don't know, I'm actually liking it, you know, a lot more. But, and I, you know, I have a couple more jobs lined up as possibilities that I might be going for. But in the meantime, I'm still focused on, you know, and especially during these quarantine times, it's like, you know, you can sit. It's like back when I was down with chronic whatever depression and fatigue, it's like I was doing stuff, but then I wasn't doing much, and just sitting there most of the time at home playing games on my computer, and it's like, you know, I wasn't doing much. I'd ride my bike into town, and then I'd ride home. Ride my bike into town to go to a doctor's appointment or a counselor, and then ride home. And it's like, you know, I wasn't really doing much. And even during these quarantine times, you know, I should be working on writing my next book, but I'm still formulating and writing down, you know, taking notes every now and again, formulating my next book. But, you know, I'm still out there making content online. That's another big thing with me, is making content online on my Instagram and Facebook. And I also have a podcast, and I've started on YouTube, just haven't gone full force in that yet, which is what I told Gary Vee when I met him back in 2017. Yeah, I've met Gary Vaynerchuk. Gary Vee, found out he was speaking in Portland back in 2017. Took a day off work, went down to Dutch Brothers Annual Leadership Conference. Heard all the motivational speakers through the day. That was a phenomenal day. Gary Vee gets up there, you know, and I get on or listen to his keynote speech. I wasn't going to get up on the mic because I was hurting, and I had run half marathon over there in Gig Harbor the day before, and did a faceplant finish 20 feet before the finish line, smack on the pavement, and bent my eyeglasses, got a big gash in the end of my brow up there, and took two butterfly stitches that the aid station put in there. But anyway, so I'm hurting the next day, sitting there on the hard bench the whole day, waiting for Gary Vee to get up there. And so I'm waiting for the line to dwindle down, people up there on the mic during Q&A, and get up there on the mic during Q&A, and I'm like, "Hey, Gary Vee, what's up, bro?" And he's like, "Hey, how you doing?" And I'm like, "Hey, my name's Shane, and I don't even work for Dutch Bros." Everyone had been introducing themselves as working for Dutch Bros and wherever they worked at. And I'm like, "Yeah, I don't even work for Dutch Bros." And he's like, "You don't work for Dutch Bros? Did you break in here?" And I'm like, "No, I didn't break in. Found out you were speaking down here. Took the day off work, rolled down from Sumner, Washington, just to hear you speak." He's like, "Well, I'm flattered, bro. But seriously, I think it would have been way cooler if you just snuck in." And, you know, anyway, just a phenomenal guy there. By the end of the conversation, you know, since I introduced myself, you know, as an author, brain injury, MS, I just, you know, briefly went over, told them about my story. You know, still moving forward, wrote a book, has done well so far. And he says, "Rather than giving you one tidbit right here and now, I'm going to fly you to New York City. You're going to spend the day with me and my team at VaynerMedia, and we'll show you how to do it." And they did. And I got on YouTube. I got on Daily V twice, once in Daily V 316 when I met him there in Portland, because he put the whole keynote and Q&A there on his YouTube channel. And I also got on Daily V 346, which was his whole day there in New York when I was there. And, you know, so I got two little bits of fame there. And I don't know. That's just how my life is, you know. But it just, you know, seems like it isn't going nowhere. And then, bam, you know, so long as I keep trying, keep making effort, keep putting forth the effort, you know, it keeps progressing, keeps moving on. And I'm sorry, I have to get this out. Something I heard recently or watched and listened to. I don't know if you're familiar with Simon Sinek. He's an author and speaker. He's another phenomenal guy. You got to check him out. But he's got a book, and I've yet to read any of his books. I've just watched his YouTube videos. And the first one was... what was that? TED Talk. Okay. And it was up here in Seattle a few years ago. And he wrote a book and about Start With Why. And it's like, you know.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I've read that book.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, yeah. And it's like, you know, don't just start with, you know, don't just start with facts. Start with why. You know, and you've read the book, and yeah. you know what he's talking about. That's why, you know, it's like Apple. That's why Apple's done so well, is because, you know, they put the why, they start with why, you know. We have an innovative product, you know, and it does this, does that, does this and that. And I forget what all he says, but it's like, you know, and by the way, would you like to buy one of our, you know, iPhones or one of our computers or, you know. And anyway, it start with why. Wonderful concept. And the one I really latch on to is, and I want to read his book called The Infinite Game. But he's giving, I watched a YouTube video where he's given a talk about, and he talked about the difference between a finite game and an infinite game. And he's talking about, you know, a finite game is defined as known players, set rules, and an agreed upon objective. Like, and he brings up baseball. Okay, there's a set number of players, you know the number of players there are on the field, and, you know, there's only so many that are going to be there, and there's a set of rules you have to go by. If you don't go by them, you get penalized, and there's an agreed-upon end of the game. You get to that point, whoever's got the most points wins, least points loses. Infinite game, there's an unknown number of players, you know, it can be an infinite number of players. They can, you know, drop out. They can come in. They can drop out. The rules are changeable, changing as, you know, the circumstances warrant or whatever. And the only objective of the game is to keep the game in play as long as possible. And rather than living a finite life, getting to a certain point and calling it good, I like to live the infinite life. That's how I think about it.
And you talk a lot about that in the second half of your book, about being able to push and search for more and better and build your life. One of the reasons I had brought up about you being a dishwasher is that for me, because right now I supplement my income working three nights a week for Domino's delivering pizzas. So there's a little bit of a connection there. And I've had people tell me, oh, you're so smart. Why don't you get this job? Why don't you get that job? Well, I worked for 12 years as a manager overseeing distribution centers. And it was a very high stressful job. And I walked away from that. It'll be 2 years this June. And, you know, not making the money and making less than half what I was making before. It's been a struggle. And I've had people tell me, you know, you should be doing this or you could be doing that, you know, and you talk about having to stay true to your path, you know, what is your path, where are you going, and staying true to that, not getting sidetracked on what other people's plans for you might be or how they think you might be able to get there faster or better. And then you also talked about, that I also found was encouraging, is sometimes, you know, we're on our path and we're walking, and either we do get sidetracked, as has happened to me different times in my life. It's like, oh, you get tired of the struggle, or I get tired of the struggle. So I think, okay, well, maybe if I do this, I can still do I can be doing this, but I can still work on this. And then I'm over here, and next thing I know, this is all consuming, and I'm not working on what I really want to be working on. So then I have to pull myself back over and start over again because I've lost so much momentum. And your book really encourages people that it's okay. It's okay if you're not making what you want to be making right now. You know, stay true to your path. It's okay if you get sidetracked or you feel like you're taking, for every step forward, you're taking two steps back. Stay on your path. And that's what I loved about your book so much, the most, was, you know, you talk about all these things that can come up that that can cause you to get sidetracked, but it's about the finding the passion, staying in the passion. And you bring humor to your book. There's a couple of times in there. One of them when you were talking about when you did the hike on Camp Myrrh, And you had made the comment that that you got really high that day. But you were talking about the elevation because it was like 10,000 feet in the, you know, but it was just a little, just kind of a little bit of that. And then later on in the book, you made a reference to about being balanced and having a balanced life. And you're talking about your MS and everything else, but you were making a play on words.
Yeah.
And so your book isn't overly serious. It's got some serious undertones, but you bring rawness because you bring yourself into it. You bring humor into it. You've just got all these really great little nuggets for people. You talked briefly about having a motivational blog. And you were just saying now that you're doing a podcast?
Yeah. I've started the blog, and I every time I, you know, think about it or hear someone talk about a blog online, I'm like, oh, that's right, duh. I have a blog I started, but haven't done anything. Oh, no, I haven't done anything with it in a couple of years. I probably need to get back on there and do something with it. That my blog is on my website, www.shaynikolich.com.
Okay.
And, for anyone listening, that's all one word, shaynikolich.com, shaneniconicolich.com. And, I probably should get back to that blog, but I do make, lots of content on Facebook and Instagram. Probably I do at least 2 posts a day. Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. I just do my post on Instagram because there's 2 buttons on there you can highlight or turn on, and it sends your post to instantly to Facebook and Twitter, and I just send the same post to all 3. But maybe I should differentiate between the platforms, but whatever. So far as my podcast, it's Positive Vibes, PODSITIVE, and then Vibes, VIBES. Positive Vibes, making positivity and gratitude louder in a podcast world. Yeah, I'm just about putting positivity out there and, you know, positive vibes. You hear so much, you know, it's like turn on the news. You hear so much negativity and car accidents, how bad the traffic is. And the news articles, find out who got shot today, you know, what major crimes happened. It's like, you know, what wars are starting. It's like, you know, I just want to put out positive vibes and positivity. So that's what I'm doing, you know, by writing my book, trying to, you know, put a little inspiration, motivation out there. And, you know, on my podcast, you know, trying to get a hold of the positive people and get them on my podcast. Or like I started out reading my positive posts on Facebook and Instagram, reading my posts, you know, and just putting that on my podcast to make some content.
Where could somebody find that podcast if they wanted to listen to it? I'd love to listen to it.
Anywhere podcasts are listened to. I do my podcasts on Anchor, and it's an app on my phone. And I can either, you know, do it on a phone call with someone, or, you know, just have it set on speakerphone there. Or I can, you know, upload an audio file on there and put that on my podcast, which I've done a couple times. I did a podcast with a friend here in Tacoma. She already has a podcast. We recorded her podcast at her office where she does it, where her like recording studio or what have you, and then she sent me the file and I just uploaded it to mine. Anyway, using Anchor, my podcast is broadcast to pretty much everywhere podcasts are available. I'm on iTunes, I'm on iHeartRadio, it's Spotify, SoundCloud.
Okay.
It's all over.
All right. Well, we're going to be running out of time here, so this might be the last topic we get to talk about, but I wanted you to talk with our listeners about living the prisoned life, pleasant life, and passionate life. Is that too much?
So far as like the prisoned life, pretty much I was imprisoned, if you will, by my, by limitations. I was essentially imposing upon myself, from lists of symptoms of both the brain injury and multiple sclerosis, and you know, feeling that I wasn't, I have this going on, I'm not worth, you know, moving forward, I'm just gonna stay here because I can't move on. I just made it up in my mind that I was, basically, I imprisoned myself and made it up in my mind that that's where I belonged and that's where I was gonna stay. And then moved on a little further. I ended up getting out of that prison, moving on a little further, and getting to a state where I was pleasant. You know, I felt pleasant, or a state that felt pleasant. And I was comfortable, didn't really feel like doing much, so I was comfortable, didn't want to do anything, so that was it. I was fine there. And a little bit of time went on, realized, okay, this isn't cool, I want to move on from here. And I realized, that was at the point where I realized, okay, if I sit with this multiple sclerosis and brain injury and whatever other stuff I got going on right now, I'm just going to fall back into that depression and go back to that point, you know, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually where I was at. When I was, I think, 17 or 18 and got to the point where I was gonna, actually, I think I was 17, yeah, 17, when I got to the point where I was just like, okay, too much, this is too much, and I was just gonna kill myself. And, you know, I got out of that, and life went on, but, you know, I never want to go back to that spot again. Realized I was going to go back to that spot if I just stayed in one spot in this pleasant life where I felt comfortable, you know. I don't want to go backwards, so I might as well go forward. And so I just decided that I needed to do something, so I decided to get passionate about my life. And as a matter of fact, you know, now it's like I'm in the process. Of course, it's slowed down because of the quarantine, pretty much at a standstill, but I'm in the process with a friend of making my book into a movie, and, you know, making a movie about my life to inspire and motivate people.
That's exciting. How far along are you in your process? Do you guys have like an end date on when you think you might be able to have it actually go to film?
There's no, like I said, everything's at a standstill right now. And I just sent a text to my buddy, actually a coworker at the restaurant where I was working. He's into film production. I sent him a text the other day because we've been going around getting shots all over the area, you know, shots of where I've lived and where I've been and everything. And he's at the point now where he just needs a new computer, a new PC to work with, and, you know, sort of at a standstill because no one's working. He's out of work too, same as me, so we're not working at the restaurant, so not making money. So yeah, but he did let me know once that he's already got connections in Hollywood, or at least, you know, connections up in the film production industry, and he's already got a couple people that might want to buy my story. So
that's really exciting, and I'll definitely be watching for it. You know, the reason I brought up the prison pleasant passionate life is I think a lot of times, I think a lot of people find themselves in maybe not all three areas, but definitely at least in one of the two areas. And I know that a lot of people who are trying to build their own business and stuff often cycle through all three of those. Mm-hmm. You know, you find yourself in a prison, that prison state of mind where you don't feel like you're worthy, or you don't think maybe you're smart enough. There are people out there that know more than you. And so you find yourself kind of prisoned in that, and then you might find some inspiration or pull yourself out of that, and then you're in that pleasant state where, oh, this is good, this is happy, or you've been really building and struggling things for a really long time, and then you just kind of get tired and you think, oh, I should just, you know, maybe I should just sit here for a minute and, you know, this isn't so bad, but then that passion will kick back in. And you ended your book with a lot of different sayings from motivational speakers and sayings that really inspired you. Sayings that I love, inspirational sayings. I have them all over my house. I have them all over my office. And one of the ones that I've taken from your book that I really, really like was one of your own. And I don't know if it's your own or if it came from somebody else, but you said, change requires at least a little bit of insanity. And I love that, because sometimes I think this is so crazy, you know, it's like my dreams are so big and so audacious that I'm just like, I'm crazy for even trying. But, you know, if it wasn't there. And when you look at all the greats and where a lot of people come from right now, the first one that pops into my mind is Colonel Sanders. You know, he was already an older gentleman. And what he wanted to do was just outrageous for the time. But look, you know, where his company is now. Mm. And so, unfortunately, and I have a whole other page. So I want to inspire and encourage, hold your book up, please, Shane.
Oh.
You to either go on Amazon and purchase his book, or I actually got it on the Kindle version and read it on there. But it is a great book. It's a great book for people who just enjoy reading other people's stories and see what they've come through to find a little bit of inspiration. It's a great book for anybody who is building a business of any type. There's just a lot of really great stuff in there.
Can I say something real quick?
Of course.
Okay. I just wanted to throw it out there. If you go to my website, www.shanenikolich.com, there's links at the bottom of the homepage there to go to Amazon or BarnesandNoble.com, and you can purchase my book through either of those three forms, hardback, paperback, or ebook. It's on Amazon Kindle, and it's on the Barnes & Noble Nook. And I have seen before that it's available on Google Play as hardback, paperback, or ebook. And yeah, you can find me at shane.nikolich on Instagram. That's shane.nikolich, or Shane Nikolich on Facebook.
All right. Well, thank you, Shane. It's been a real pleasure.
Yeah, thank you very much.